Before I get you ready for the physics and the science behind optical computing, I'll start by telling you something which everyone in this audience, or probably any audience, knows. Our computers every 7 months get smaller, and they get faster and cooler. And I guess the driving force or the motivation, at least one of the motivations behind that, is so that you can put your device in your pocket. At the same time, cost is a big driving force. But there's also an engineering reason, right? When you shrink the size of your transistor, as well as your integrated circuit, what you're really doing is you're reducing the distance over which your electrons travel, you know, which carry the information. And so really, you are making computation faster. At the same time, when you shrink things, Ohm's law, the resistance that these electrons feel, decreases. And so you dissipate less heat. So your computers dissipate much less heat, and they're cooler, no pun intended there. So right now, we are at 22 nanometers. And you know, that's a technology that operates at you know, several gigabits per second. And it's amazing how fast we are making our transistors smaller. At least from the physics community point of view, we are getting really quickly to the scale where transistors are atomic in size. In this graphic here, I'm showing you a transistor that consists of 8 phosphorus atoms, really the smallest transistor. But in the process, at least we physicists have started worrying a lot. We are sort of reaching a limit where sort of the conventional physics of electronic transistors doesn't work anymore. We're reaching a quantum limit. For instance, even in the commercial realm of computing, by 2020, we'll be at a 5-nanometer wide transistor. Why is this 5-nanometer number important? The wavelength, the spread, electrons are waves, the spread of an electron in silicon is 5 nanometers, which means if you have a transistor 5 nanometer wide, your electron is at both places at the same time. It can tunnel right through. Your transistor is never going to be off. You can't do computations. And so that's really the limit that we are reaching. And then there are many other problems. For instance, your current and voltage isn't proportional. They have quantum jumps. There can be fluctuations. Your electrons like to spend a lot more time at the surface of the device rather than doing useful computational work inside. And so really, does this mean that we are going to stop progressing as we have been according to the Moore's law? Every week, if you read sort of the news about the semiconductor industry, you read a lot about this, that sort of the progress according to Moore's law is going to stop. But that's not really true. We've learned from history, right? We've always made paradigm shifts in our technology to keep moving forward, to keep advancing computing hardware and make computers much more powerful. So we'll do it. That's not our X. Our X is when we get to 2020, right, and we reach this quantum limit, what's going to be this paradigm shift, right? That's our X. And basically, the solution I'm proposing is let's just chuck electrons as the medium of information and computation. What's the fastest thing we know? What's the fastest object we know of? Light. Let's use photons, right? Just to give you some quick numbers. The fastest an electron can travel in silicon, and that's the maximum physical limit, is 10 to the power 5 meters per second. And we don't really operate close to that. How fast can a photon move? 10 to the power 8 meters per second, right? Depending on the medium, of course. I'm talking here about a factor of 1,000. So if you replace electrons by photons, you can enhance at the same size scale of the computer the bandwidth or the computational speed by 3 orders of magnitude. I'm not talking about 10x or incremental gains, but really a huge gain in speed. At the same time, photons don't really respect Ohm's law. There is no resistance to the motion of light. And so your computers are going to be a lot cooler, much less energy dissipation. Well, now, the truth is, of course, I'm not the first one to propose this, not by a huge margin. IBM actually already has a prototype of an optoelectronic chip. If you look at this, basically, you know, it's a complicated diagram, but the basic essence is they use light to move, to bus the signal around, right? So it's really the light that's carrying your digital signals around. But this this device is a little bit unsatisfying, at least to me. You're still using electronic transistors to do the computation, right? So in this device, you have to convert your photonic signal into electrons for computation, and then back into photonic signal for the actual propagation. That's wasteful. You need a lot more components, and you're still limited by the physics of electronic transistors, right? And so really what we need is what I've sketched here, right? It's a very simple sketch. You need an optical transistor, a transistor that processes or computes with light. So basically you need a transistor that can transmit light in its on state and not transmit light in the off state. As simple as that, right? And that can be the basic building block of a computer that runs with light. HP had something like this. It's called a silicon microring resonator. That's the ring right there. And if a beam of light passes by that ring, the ring absorbs this light. If you apply a tiny voltage to the ring, you turn off that absorption. So this is really like an optical switch or a modulator. What's the problem then? The smallest you can make this ring is 3 microns. And so what you gain in terms of speed, you're losing in terms of size. That's like moving backwards, right? And so our approach, my approach that I'm going to be proposing here, is to use nanoscience to really make the building block of optical computing. What I'm showing you here is a tiny piece, a tiny particle of gold. It's a metal nanoparticle. And a metal nanoparticle really is an antenna, right? It resonates with a specific frequency of light. The electrons in the, I guess, the movie star, but you can just look at my hand, wave back and forth. The electrons in the metal oscillate in resonance with the light. It's like a tiny antenna. And you can use this antenna to confine light, control light, and even channel light much below the so-called physical diffraction limit of light. You can move light at the nanoscale and control it at the nanoscale. Now, I'm a chemist, and the thing that I like to sell the most about these nanoparticles, we've figured out, we as a community, have figured out the technology of these to such an extent that it's very easy and inexpensive to make these nanoparticles. In fact, I'm confident if I gave you a recipe, even those in the audience who hated chemistry lab could go into my lab and come back with a vial of these colorful particles. And how many nanoparticles does a vial like this have? 1 billion. And these are like printable inks. You can print them on substrates, and the substrates can be flexible. And you can change the size, and as you see here, you can control the size and the shape, and that can tune the frequency of the light that you work with. Okay? As a graduate student, one of the most interesting things that I worked with was these antennas can talk to each other. That's what you need to bus your signals around. So if you put a bunch of metal nanoparticles close to each other, you can actually move photons from one place to the other. In fact, Harry Atwater at Caltech actually showed that. When you put metal nanoparticles in a row and you shine light at one end through this electromagnetic communication, your photons travel. And it's not like electrons diffusing through the circuit. It's really a coherent coupling of the light through this tiny little waveguide. Okay, but that's the wiring. What about the computation, right? How do we compute with light? And that's where we learn a lesson. And we learn a lesson from history. Metal antennas or metals are boring. They can make wires, but they can't make switches. They can't be switched on and off. A metal is what it is, right? And so we've already learned from the revolution called electronics that you need to really use semiconductors or doped semiconductors, which you can switch on and off. And that's the example of the first transistor, which was made by Shockley and Bardeen, who incidentally was also at the University of Illinois, where I run a nanoscience research group. And so from this, you know, it was very easy to apply the analogy. Just like electronics, the revolution called electronics was brought about by really adopting doped semiconductors, maybe that's what we should do. We should make tiny antennas from doped semiconductors, doped meaning full of charges. And so that's what a postdoc and I, when I was a postdoc, set out to do. And we made semiconductors of this earth-abundant, very inexpensive material called copper sulfide with really good control. You're really looking at 2 nanometer quantum dots, semiconductor quantum dots that are going to be building blocks of the transistor that I'm going to show you. The next step was to dope it with charges. You know what's the amazing thing about nanoscience? When you have a dot that's 1 or 2 nanometers in size. You can simply put 3 or 4 electronic charges into it, and you can make it behave like a metal, right? The densities are the same as in the bulk. All you need is 2 or 3 charges that you can put in, and you can turn this semiconductor into a metal antenna. So there you go. That's the real transistor that you can achieve. So basically, I'm really going to be showing you some data here that we've generated in the lab. We're very excited, right? As a postdoc, I made this optical transistor work. Basically, in the black curve, you see sort of, you know, we're shining photons on these tiny nanocrystals, and we're looking at the photons that are scattered by the crystal. When it's off, you don't see a scattering of photons, and you don't really see a signal. And then when you apply a voltage, just like in an electronic transistor, when you apply an electrochemical voltage, meaning you pull out electrons from this transistor, it turns on, as you can see. And so that's like a turn on of your optical transistor. Of course, it wouldn't be interesting if you can't turn it off, and you apply the reverse potential, and you can push the electrons back into this tiny little nanocrystal, and you can turn your transistor off. So really speaking, what I'm showing you here is the smallest transistor that works or does bit operations with photons, right? But we are still a long way, let me admit. We've just shown a working optical transistor, which I think is a big piece of the puzzle, right? But we haven't made a logic device yet, right? At the same time, if you have small transistors, you are also going to need small lasers, light sources, small detectors to collect the signals for the computation, and then some technology. We've heard talks about self-assembly, some technology like self-assembly, where you can put all these tiny nanoparticles together into an integrated circuit, starting from bottom, going to up, right? So basically, the X that I proposed has a multidimensional solution, right? But I think the big piece of the puzzle is optical is the optical transistor. What I should also mention in closing is that the same technology of nanoscience and semiconducting and metal nanoparticles are also driving advances in the area of lasers, photodetectors, and self-assembly. So really what I'm trying to convince you is that material science, cutting-edge material science at the nanometer length scale can really make computing with light possible. Thank you.